Good morning, everybody, to our today's session from Dynamo Express. Today's talk is about model parameterization in ANSA, and this talk will be given by Dirk Dreisig from Lasso Engineering. Dirk actually studied aerospace engineering at the University of Stuttgart, and now he's part of the support team at Lasso Engineering and is responsible for ANSA and META and optimization and automatization. Yeah, and today he will give a talk about model parameterization in ANSA. This, by the way, that's the first part, and next week there will be a second part regarding a similar topic. Okay, so with that being said, the stage is yours. Take the microphone.
Yes, hello everybody from my side as well. I hope you can hear me quite well.
Yes, we can hear you.
At least you can hear me.
I can. Okay. Hear you, so I think everyone else as well.
For those who did not yet muted their microphones, please mute your microphones. Otherwise, there will be a lot of noise. So, yeah. Today we will have a short look on the features of ANSA concerning parameterization of our models. We will see the possibilities that ANSA offers, especially in order to parameterize our models for an optimization procedure, on which we will have a look next week. So there are different types of parameterization. The first one is the shape optimization or the shape modification. When we want to change sizes of parts of our model, for example, here, the location, size of the B pillar, this is typically done with morphing functionalities in ANSA. Have a closer look on that in a few minutes. Another type of parameters are the so-called ANSA parameters, especially if you want to modify card values, for example, property thickness values and different material values or the material itself that is used, but also connection properties. Here, the distance of spot welds along a spot weld line. All these things can be parameterized by using ANSA parameters. And for everything else, like when you want to do some mesh studies or if you want to do optimization with kinetics, we can use scripting. All right, let's come to the morphing. Morphing actually can be applied as well or on FE models, so pure meshes, no matter what type of elements are used, and also geometry, which means the cut faces. We have two main methods in ANSA. The first one is the box morphing. Box morphing means we put our model in so-called morphing boxes. Depending on what we want to do, we fit and adjust the boxes onto the geometry like it's done here on this example. And then we move the boxes and everything which is inside the boxes is moved accordingly. The other possibility is the so-called direct morphing. With direct morphing, no boxes need to be created. We can directly touch our geometry, our meshes. So say how specific areas should be moved and define areas like here, the purple one that is morphed. Okay, let's have a look on the different types of box morphing. At first, we see the different types of boxes that are available. We have different types of 3D boxes: hexahedral, pentahedral, tetrahedral, like typical solid FE elements as well, but also some cylindrical boxes for modifying pipes, for example. But there are also 2D boxes for sheet parts where we do not want to change dimensions in thickness direction, but only in the area. These 2D boxes, they have a specific thickness, like shell elements, and everything which is contained within this, let's say, virtual 3D box, this is affected by the morphing later on. And one dimension less, 1D boxes, they have a specific diameter, and everything which is contained inside this pipe, let's say, morphing pipe, will be affected by the morphing. So if you do not want to change the size, the diameter, only the shape of the line, then you can go for 1D boxes. So let's see how we can create boxes. Actually, this depends a little bit on the model and on what you actually want to do with the boxes later on. Typically, you when you create, for example, 3D boxes, you create them around the area that you want to modify. So you can just select the area and say you want to create a box around it, either in this according to a specific coordinate system, or simply adapt it to the shape of the area. So we can create offset boxes around them. These are typically used in order to connect to neighboring areas in order not to detach the area that is affected by the morphing from the rest of the model. So kind of buffer boxes. We can split boxes and attach edges, but also surfaces onto the geometry, like it's done here. The front line of the roof is attached to a morphing edge. Some additional control points are inserted in order to capture the curvature. We can sweep or collide a cross section through a model according to its shape. And we can use kind of wrap functionalities in order to build boxes that are well wrapped around our geometry. And some more, like selecting explicitly some points or some lines, edges, or connecting boxes by their faces. So, and how can we modify the boxes when they are created? Actually, the boxes are modified by moving their control points. These control points, they act like nodes of an FE model. So these are the nodes of our box, morph box model. We can move them in any direction according to any coordinate system. We can rotate them like, well, these normal transformation possibilities that affect for other types of entities in ANSA as well. We can slide or extend them, which means we move the control points along existing also curved edges of the box. This is meant with slide or extend. Extend is just the extension over into the next box or over an end of the edge. We can change an angle by keeping the control points sliding on their neighboring edges. Fitting to edge surface, I already mentioned. Well, actually, here are some target lines not visible. We just see this, the result. Yeah. So this was a kind of edge fitting. For cylindrical boxes, we can modify the radius. You can also well, have some nested cylindrical boxes with some consecutive radii. So more than one radii can be, radius can be changed with a cylindrical morphing box. So here the inner radius of a morphing box, this cylindrical morphing box is changed. And also some more functions available. If you have a symmetrical model, like a car body, which is left on the left side, symmetrical to the right side, more or less. We can make use of so-called link morphing boxes in order to define everything only once and then link the boxes and also all the affected parameters, if we have some, accordingly. So we can have link morphing boxes with respect to a symmetry plane or a mirror plane, like here. Left, right side. We can have link boxes also with specific transformations. Like here, the green one is the master. The orange ones or the brown ones are the slaves. So, and everything which we do on the master is done to the slaves as well. Here according to a rotation axis. So a 2D box, blue one is the master, the other five are the slaves. All right. Especially if you have well, several areas that you want to change the shape of, there are different let's say strategies to realize what you want to do. You can create one group of boxes that is split in order to capture everything, all the morphing actions that you want to do, but it is more effective and more robust and safe to have a separate group of boxes for each modification that you want to implement. And then we are at the so-called box-in-box morphing. Let's see this example here. We have how we call it, a global morphing, a global modification. And this is the position of the B pillar here. Between left and right side, we have this this green part, which is here. This should be at the same location where the B pillar is, of course. But we also want to change the size of this cross member. So I call it a local modification. So we create boxes for the global. Here, for the global modification, and separate independent boxes for the local modification. So the local and the global group, they are not connected by any means. And then we can morph at first the global modification and afterwards the local one. And you should take care on this sequence. Always do the modification from the outside to the inside. Otherwise, it may happen that if you do it the other way around, when you increase the width of this cross member, the nodes and also the control points of the inner boxes, they move outside the boxes of the global modification, and then the global morphing will fail. So always do the morphing from the outer to the inner. So there are a lot of different tools in ANSAR. And one of the big advantage of ANSAR is that all these tools are or can be coupled together. So we can We have, for example, a kinetics tool. It's a multi-body dynamic solver, which can be used for positioning things besides doing kinetic simulation. And we can link this kinetics solver also with morphing. So for example, we can add morph control points of our boxes in kinetic bodies in order to morph, for example, here this foam by simply moving the bodies with the kinetics tool. So the morphing is controlled by the kinetics. But also the other way round is possible. Can include rigid bodies in morph boxes, and you morph and the position of the bodies changes, of course. All right. When you do morphing, you may want to store specific shapes of the model in order to retrieve them at a later point. This can be done by using so-called history states, morph history states. It's illustrated here. It's such a feature phone. We have different stages here, an initial state and some others where different morphing actions have been applied. but you can not only let's say activate or go back to these several saved history states, you can also create interpolations between them in an arbitrary way. So the big advantage of using morphing boxes is that you can reapply them quite easy on multiple and similar models. Just store them with all their parameters in a separate ANSA database and merge them in another model, maybe for another discipline or similar sized model, and reuse them without having to create them from scratch again. Okay, let's finish the box morphing at this point and have a look on the other big topic concerning morphing, the so-called direct morphing. Direct morphing has been enhanced and spread a lot in the last years in ANSA. The main advantage of the direct morphing is that you do not have to create boxes at all, but you directly touch the model, the elements, or the geometry. Meanwhile, you can use also parameters for almost every direct morphing action in order to use them in an optimization. So let's see some examples of direct morphing in ANSA. At first here, a direct morphing of this mirror case, then FE mesh. And direct morphing actually is, or it behaves always the same, no matter what type of direct morphing you apply. So for example, if we do a rotation or a translation or a fitting, we always have a group of entities, the so-called control entities, on which we apply a specific movement. For example, in this case, a rotation. So these control entities, they are actually not morphed, but they move in a specific way. So we apply a prescribed motion on it, let's say. All right. So besides these control entities, we have the actual morphed entities. In this case, it's the area between the mirror case and the A pillar here. Purple areas, and then we have a boundary to the rest of the model, blue one. I hope you can see the blue line here. And then we morph it, which means we move the green area, and the purple area is morphed. And the definition is actually much easier than to create a box, fit it to the shape, and then use box morphing. Another example, a fitting of edges. In this case, the origin or the control entities actually is a sequence of edges. This is fitted to a target. We have some rows of elements that are actually morphed, and again, the border to the rest of the model, our boundary. So, and here you see a typical result of morphing when the morphed area actually is quite small compared to the distance the morphing is applied. So, usually by morphing, we get quite well stretched or squeezed elements that can hardly directly be used for a simulation later on. So that's why you can always apply a reconstruction of the morphed area in order to smooth or to get a better mesh that can be used for the simulation later on. So the algorithm knows what actually is the area that is morphed that needs a reconstruction, and it can be applied automatically on this area. Here an example on fitting. Again, an edge fitting of the geometry now, not an FE mesh, but the geometry. So we have this time multiple source and target lines. Of course, you can also use the whole, let's say, U profile, 1, 2, 3 as a single origin and target. But then it may happen that here the corner of the green area does not exactly match the corner of the orange area. So that's why it's better to use separate origin target segments for each, say, smooth line. So one for the left, one for the rear, and one for the right. The morphed area are the surrounding faces, and the boundary, again, the rest to the undeformed model. So how my mouse hangs time to time. So here you see the morphing action. Of course, this can be applied also to solid meshes. If you imagine that this is the surface of a CFD model, and here attached is the whole fluid domain, can not only morph the surface of the model, but also accordingly the solid elements around them, the cells of the fluid domain. Here a similar example to what we have seen before with the box morphing. This can also be achieved by direct morphing, sliding on specific predefined curves. Without the need to create boxes. So here an example of surface fitting. We have an initial surface, the yellow one here, with some underlying parts that should be morphed with the yellow one. And we want to fit it on a new target surface. Maybe the next version of the car is a little bit bigger, a bit higher. And due to the lack of existing cut files for the whole car. We just need the old, we just use the old one and fit it to the new shape. So the yellow area in this case is our control entities, our green entities that we want to fit onto the red area, the target surface. And the underlying parts is what is morphed, in fact. Another example, a little bit more what to be morphed. Again, the yellow area here, the roof, is the initial surface. The blue one is the target surface. And the side panels, they should be morphed. Another example is the morphing by using cross-section curves. If you don't have a target shape, maybe just some slices, or you want to see in which area you want to change the cross-sections, you can use cross-section curves on distinct cutting planes. Here we have the original cross sections of this A pillar and some target curves in the respective planes. And by fitting the original cross section curves onto the target curves, the part is morphed. Well, actually, everything which is between these cross-section planes belongs to the morphed area. There are some specific functions concerning morphing of holes, changing, for example, the diameter of 2D holes here. You can not only apply it on, let's say, the first row of elements, the washer, but arbitrary ones. The same possible for, we mean by call them 3D holes. In older versions, they were called tubes, to separate them from the 2D holes in a shell mesh. So for the 3D holes, the same is possible. Can identify first the holes and then change their diameters. Another functionality is the creation and the modification afterwards of so-called beads and embosses. It belongs also to the morphing. Not the creation itself, but we can move these features later on. So, for example, here we created such a bead. Create circular flange openings or other shapes. And you know, in the latest versions, we have all these types of features as separate entities that can be directly touched, and you can work with the features directly. So we have features like beats, feature rib, and on all these features we can apply so-called design changes. And this is what we see here on this slide. We have a feature bead, we have a feature hole, and we can slide, move them on the underlying surface, copy them to specific locations, and the source as well as the target area are remeshed, reconstructed accordingly to good mesh around them. Another example of these design change procedures is the change of a position of a part. So we can move one part on along another one and adapt all the flanges, all the areas where these are in contact. So the sidewalls, this member. So we have here. The red one is moved. You see the flanges. They adapt to the target location of the underlying part. Now, when we do morphing, the whole morphed area is kind of squeezed or stretched. So if we have some specific features in the morphed area, like round holes, for example, they will not stay round. We will see it here. Here it is, it's more or less round. If we do the morphing, we squeeze the area and this gets oval. In order to avoid this, we can apply morphing constraints. There are different types of morphing constraints. Here we have used nested elements. They look like RBE elements in the FE, and we can apply specific degrees of freedom for the morphing action on these nested elements. For example, we have here an area that where this nested element just moves as a rigid. So the location of the reference point is simply be morphed, but the nodes attached on this nested elements are not morphed by the morphing. They follow as a rigid the reference point. Another example here. Here, this nested element is not moved at all. So we can even constrain all degrees of freedom for the morphing and keep a specific area, although it is included in the morphed area, as fixed. These nested elements can be applied on box morphing or on direct morphing. Here we have some other examples. Here, this bead or this hole should not be morphed as a shape. It itself, but its location should be follow the shape of the whole part. Or if you have such a cross member like we have seen in the roof example before, there are several holes. When we increase the width, the holes should stay, should keep their shape, but their position should change according to the size changed. There are other types of constraints. In this example, we see a so-called path follower constraint. If we want to move this, well, here on my screen, it's green. This green area to the left or to the right. Well, the nodes here will change this curvature here. We'll see it here on the right side. If we just move the nodes to the left, we change the curvature here. So if we use this parse follower constraint, we say that these nodes, they should not move to the left or to the right like the general morphing, but they should morph along the path, along the existing edges. This can be done with such a path follow constraint. This is not applicable to box morphing. This kind of morphing constraints works for direct morphing. Another constraint is the flange constraint. We increase the width of the orange part. Without any constraint, we get intersections here. With a flange constraint, the nodes are lifted a bit in order to avoid intersections. All these morphing actions that we have seen, either box morphing or direct morphing, can be parameterized, which means I can not only use them interactively once, but I can apply parameters on them, and by this use them later on in an optimization. So otherwise I would not have shown them to you here. These parameters, so-called morphing parameters, if you have a lot of them, it might be a little bit difficult to judge how they change the model and to see effects of one parameter onto the other. So there's a possibility to loop through the range of the parameters and get a video in order to see how the model behaves when the values of the morph parameters are changed. We can even change the view during the video, so not always looking at the same location or from the same viewport. You see the model change through the change of the parameters. I know that the mesh here is not what you are used to get from ANSA typically. So sometimes it may be necessary to decrease the number of morphing parameters in order not to have too many design variables when you do the optimization later on. So there's a possibility, maybe you want to use it once, to kind of create a macro to record a macro to record what happened through changing morphing parameters, and then to interpolate between start and end point of this recording. So let's assume here we have an initial shape of the model and we have some morphing actions that we apply here, for example, an edge fitting of the boxes, and then we move some control points. So different morphing actions that lead to a target shape. And this was recorded. And then we can interpolate between the starting and the target, the end position, with just one parameter, so-called deformation parameter. Something which has nothing to do with direct morphing or box morphing is a specific parameter called tailored weld blank. It is for, well, optimizing tailor blanks. And this is actually a way of optimizing the PID areas with different thicknesses. So we can move these pit boundaries through the model and have this as parameter for an optimization, for example. Well, when we have when we are finished with morphing, for example, the optimization has run, and we get an optimized shape here. Usually, you want to transfer this back to the CAD model. So there's a possibility to map this. Well, I call it the deformation field through the morphing. So you can map this deformation field onto another part here, onto the original cut geometry. And you get the cut geometry in the same shape as the optimized FE model. The source for this deformation field can be quite different, can be a deformation parameter, can be some stored history states, design variables, or even a text file with coordinates and the vector when you want to apply it from an external application. All right, let's have a look on some functionalities that assist us in using the morphing functionalities. The first one are auxiliary topo entities like 3D points or curves. Even if our model is a pure FE mesh, we can create points or curves out of edges or feature lines in order to easier select source and targets for fittings, for example. Then very important, the model browser or part manager in older versions, especially if you do morphing with boxes, the box in box morphing, you have somehow distinguish between the global and the local. Morph boxes do not have a property. They could also not be put in a set or a layer or whatever, but we can put them in different parts. So we use the model browser in order to organize our morph content. You can also shade your model according to the part to see which areas belong to which morphing action. And also to select, you can easily select all the boxes of a part by the feature selection tool. And we've already seen an example, reconstruct and smooth is integrated in our morphing actions, suitable for box and direct morphing, and it improves the mesh after a morphing with quite large deformations has been applied. You see here, we have a lot of, call them off elements that violate some criteria after the morphing. So we can apply a reconstruct on this area to get better mesh, suitable mesh for the first simulation. If you want to see the deformations through morphing, we can have a fringe plot of that. It works only on FE model, so on meshes. It does not work on geometry, pure cut geometry. But on meshes, you can get a fringe of the deformation. And of course, you can use the measurement tool if you are interested in some specific measurements, like some diameters or distances. And what's quite new is a function called the DFM migration. We've seen it for the boxes. You can reuse the boxes for different models. And the question was, how can we do this with direct morphing? So for this, there exists the DFM migration tool, and this is exactly for applying DFM morphing parameters on different models. We have here, for example, a very fine model on the left side where we applied some DFM morphing, and we want to transfer this DFM morphing and apply it on another discipline model with coarser mesh, for example. So we can just transfer these areas, origin area, control entities, the morph area, boundaries, to the other model and easily apply the same morphing on the other model without the need to have the definition of this DFM parameter again. Okay. That's actually all concerning morphing. We will have a few minutes left for looking on the ANSA parameters. It's basically for all these card values of the different solvers. ANSA parameters can be of different types. We can even use expressions in order to combine parameters. You assign such a parameter typically with pressing F3 in the field. Yeah, when you move your cursor over such a field, you get a tooltip. And there you can you see that with F3 you can enter a parameter. And then by changing the parameter, the value of the card is changed as well. There's also the possibility to import and export from or to keyword star parameters for the solver that have such a parameter. In this case, it's an Abacus distributed load, so that the parameter even appears as a parameter in the solver input file. Another example where such parameters are used is the composite tool, the laminate tool. We can use parameters for varying the thickness or the nominal fiber angle. Do optimization with this. And we have already seen, you can use it in the connection manager in order parameterize connection entities like connection lines, the distance of spot welds, the diameter of spot welds, all the fields that exist there can be assigned to a parameter. Well, that's all for today. Thank you very much, Karistopoli. Hope to see or to that you have the opportunity to attend to the next week's session as well. There we will see how we set up an optimization for LSOpt. How does it work with the optimization tool, optimization task in ANSA, and see how the workflow is for that. Thanks a lot. Have a nice remaining Friday and also a nice weekend.